And great is your faithfulness. And great is your faithfulness. And you never change, you never fail, oh God. And true are your promises. And true are your promises. And you never change, you never fail, oh God. And so we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. And so we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy grace. Oh, wide is your love and grace. And you never change, you never fail, oh God.
Sing that out again. Wide is your love.
Oh, wide is your love and grace. Oh, wide is your love and grace.
You never change.
And you never change. You never fail, oh God.
And so we
raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was
and is to come.
And so we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One.
So we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One,
who was
and is to come.
Hallelujah. Lord, we exalt
you. So we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One,
who
down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied.
Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory.
Saved from sin,
Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in, oh glory to His name, oh glory to His name, oh glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Oh, glory to His name.
And oh, precious fountain that saves from sin,
I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to His name.
Oh, hallelujah.
Glory to His name. Oh, glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name.
And come to this fountain so rich
and sweet.
Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet.
Plunge in today and be made complete.
A glory to his name.
Glory to his name. Glory to his name.
There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. One more time.
Oh, glory to his name. Oh, glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, and still the truth is the cross has made you fall. Let's sing it out this morning. No matter the hurt,
no matter the hurt, or how deep the wound is, no matter the pain, and still the truth is the cross has made you fall.
Let's sing that again. No matter the bumps,
no matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, and still the truth is the cross has made you flawless. No matter the hurt, or how deep the wound is, no matter the pain, and still the truth is the cross has made you flawless.
One more time. No matter the bumps,
no matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, and still the truth is the cross has made you flawless. No matter the hurt or how deep the wound is, no matter the pain, and still the truth is the cross has made, the cross
has made. All right. So here's my family. Here's the king and queen up on the top, and there's the princes and the princess and their spouses and the family members on the bottom. All right. Okay, you can do that. So I love my family. They're not perfect. I'm not perfect. They make their mistakes. They cause me to lose some sleep every now and again. I said to Glenn the other day, I need to be in bed 10 hours to get 4 hours sleep, I think, but don't work that way. But they are precious to us. We love them. And there's nothing within reason or within the law that I wouldn't do for my children. Absolutely nothing. They know that. I'd give my life for them in a moment. In a second, I'd lay down my life for my children. They know I love them. They know we love them. And I'm glad to be a part. I've got other family members, extended family members. Mother's here with us this morning. When she moved here 3 years ago, she wondered if she would attend Evangel, and I warned her, do not attend Evangel. You got to attend WPC. So she don't have a choice. No, I'm only kidding. She's here supporting us this morning. And there are other members of my family. So I love my family, but there's another family that I want to talk about this morning. You see the title in your bulletin, and that's the family of God. The family of God. And if you have your Bibles this morning, you can turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2, and we're going to read a verse there as a text in a few moments. The book of Ephesians is a letter written by the Apostle Paul to the Gentile believers in the city of Ephesus many, many centuries ago. For whatever it's worth, it's my opinion that chapter 2 of Ephesians is one of the best explanations of the message of the gospel found anywhere in the epistles, if not the entire New Testament. If you didn't have the gospels, I think you would have a good understanding of the gospel message by reading Ephesians chapter 2. And I don't have time to break it down verse by verse this morning, but let me give you an overview of Ephesians 2 before I read my text. We're going to break it down into two sections quickly. Section 1, verses 1 to 10. The heading in my Bible is Made Alive in Jesus Christ. In this section, the Apostle Paul talks about the spiritual condition of believers before coming to faith in Jesus Christ. What we were like before we met the Lord. He points out that unbelievers are dead. We were dead in our trespasses and sins. He's talking about spiritual death there. We were alienated, separated from God. It all began in the Garden of Eden many, many years before. But Paul says, because of the sin of Adam and Eve, all who are born in sin. And we are dead in our trespasses and sins. We were followers of the ways of the world and the way of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, which is a reference to Satan. That's where we were. That was our spiritual state before we came to faith in Jesus Christ. He points out that we lived to gratify our sinful nature. We were all about ourselves, doing what we wanted to do on our terms, mapping our own course, making our own journey, if you would, without God in the picture, gratifying our sinful nature, following its desires and its thoughts. Our sinful nature, the flesh, the Bible says, is what governed our lives, is the agenda that governed us and led us. And because of this way of living, Paul says, we were object of God's wrath. That's strong language. Because of our sin, because of our rejection of God, because of our willingness to live a life outside of God, we were objects of the wrath of God. We were deserving of God's judgment. God is a God of justice. He's a God of love. And the Bible says that we need to understand the goodness and the severity of God. We like to talk about God's love and God's mercy. But we need to understand that God is a God of judgment and God will judge sin. God will judge sin. And in sin, we were objects of God's wrath. We were deserving of the judgment of God. And ultimately, that judgment is separated from God for eternity. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. Not just physical death, but spiritual death. And when we in sin, we are spiritually dead. But ultimately, God will judge those who reject His Son Jesus, and we will spend eternity separated from Him in hell. That's the wrath and the judgment of God. Not popular these days, but that is the truth of the Scripture, and we stand on that truth today. We were spiritually dead. But then Paul writes these words in verses 4 to 5 and 8 to 10. I was going to summarize it, but I thought better to read it. I love these words. It says, but God. That three-letter word, that short word, but, that conjunction there makes the entire difference, doesn't it? We were objects of God's wrath. And Paul says, but God is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. Think about that this morning. The grace of God. And then he expands on that in verse 8. He said, God saved you by His grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this, he says. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done. So none of us can boast about it, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. God says, I love you anyway. And He sent His Son out of His grace and His mercy, nothing in ourselves, nothing that I can do, nothing I can give, no matter how much I attend church, no matter how much I give to the church, no matter how much I give to the poor, No matter how kind and good I am to my family and my friends and my community, my salvation comes through Christ and Christ alone. It comes by the grace of Almighty God, the unmerited favor of God, nothing more, nothing less, but the amazing grace of God. How many are you glad for that this morning? The grace of God, no works that I could do, because if I could, I'd boast about it. But it is through the grace of God. Folks, and we'll touch on this again, Lord willing, next Sunday. But the wonderful message of the gospel is about the amazing grace of God. Salvation comes from God by grace and grace alone. God takes those who are spiritually dead and He makes them spiritually alive. If you're here this morning and you are a follower of Christ, you were dead, but you're made alive, amen? Spiritually alive. If you're listening today, whether online or in this audience, and you have yet to make a decision to follow Jesus, you are spiritually dead. You are still in your trespasses and your sin, and you need to change that. And the only way you can do that is come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and He will save you by His amazing grace. You say, Pastor, if I give this much, can I be saved? If I do this, can I be saved? The only thing you need to do is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And we'll touch on that a little later in the message. Then we come to section 2 of Ephesians 2, verses 11 to 22. In my Bible, my translation here, is the heading is One in Christ. Made alive in Christ, made one in Christ. In this section of verses, and it's a little bit technical, and I'm not going to break it down this morning. It would make for a good study. But Paul talks about the unity that takes place between Jews and Gentiles once they come to faith in Jesus Christ. He says, now in Christ you have been brought near through the blood of Jesus Christ. Gentiles who were outside of the citizenship of heaven, outside of Israel, if you would, we have come together now and we are joined together and we make up the family of God. In verse 14 to 17, he talks about how the dividing wall of hostility has been taken down by abolishing the law with its commandments and regulations to make one new community of faith. As I said, that's something we could dive into another time, and certainly an interesting section talking about Jews and Gentiles. But now we come to my text. I don't know if you can see that. It's a little bit small, but let me read it for you. It says, now all of us can come to the Father through the same Holy Spirit because of what Christ has done for us. All of us, Jew and Gentile. So now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You are citizens along with all God's holy people. A reference to the Jews. And here's my text today. You are members of God's family. Everything I just said leads up to that phrase. You are members of God's family. I said at the beginning of the message that I love my family. So glad to be a part of this family. As I said, there's another family that I love. And so glad to be a part of this morning. And I say that meaningly, I mean that this morning. I'm so glad to be a part of the family of God. Can you say amen to that this morning? I'm glad to be a part of the family of God. And for the next few minutes, and I'm trying to make cognizant of time, I want to answer three questions. Number one, what does Paul mean by the family of God? How do we become a part of the family of God? And how should members of the family of God treat each other? We're going to answer these three questions, and I know you've already made the connection. We've welcomed new families here this morning into this church family, so I thought it would be fitting to talk for a few moments about the family of God. What does Paul mean by the family of God? To put it simply this morning, the family of God makes up those who have received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Very simple. All of those who have been saved from sin by putting their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ make up the family of God. The family of God, one translation uses the words the family of faith. It is the church, to put it simply this morning. The family of God is the church. There are several places in the New Testament where familial words such as household and children and so on are applied to believers, followers of Jesus Christ or the church. We read words like brothers and sisters and household and children and so on. And these are words that are used to refer to the church. I want to remind you this morning something I know you know, and I know I've reminded you of this before. I want to do it again. The church is not the building. The church is not this building. Yes, we call this place Windsor Pentecostal Church. That's the name on our bulletin. That's the name we use. That's the official name. It's on our sign out front, Windsor Pentecostal Church. But this building is not the church. It is where the church gathers. It is where the family of God gathers, as we've done this morning. You see, the Bible talks about the church in two ways. The universal church. Universal church consists of everyone from everywhere who have come to personal faith in Jesus Christ. In other words, those who have received salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, they make up the church. And there are many denominations that fall under that category. In our community, there are a number of denominations, and denominations are man-made organizations, I guess for lack of word, that have been put in place. But believers from all communities of faith, believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, from here to the other side of the world, and multitudes have gathered under the banner of the church today. Followers of Jesus Christ. The universal church of Jesus Christ. And that's what Jesus was referring to when he said he would build his church. And I believe the Spirit of God today is moving all over the world. And I believe this morning that Jesus is building his church. I believe that men and women and boys and girls are coming to faith in Jesus Christ. And the universal church is being added onto daily. Do you believe that this morning? He is building his church. Then there's the local church. The local church is a local group of believers who come together to worship, who come together to be taught God's Word, to come together to do the work of the ministry amongst ourselves, and also who strategize and go forth and do ministry in the communities we serve. That's the local church. Let me read that again. Who come together to worship, to be taught God's Word, and do the work of the ministry amongst ourselves and in the communities we serve. So if you this morning are a follower of Jesus Christ, you're a member of the universal church by the fact that you place your faith in Jesus. And we express that new reality. Let me say that again. We express that new reality in our lives by becoming a part of a local church. I believe that's the way it works. I believe that's God's desire this morning, that when we come under the banner of faith in Jesus Christ, it is automatic then that we ought to embed ourselves to become a part of a local family of believers. You may disagree with me on that point, and that's entirely your prerogative, but I believe that's what the Word of God teaches. It tells us that we ought not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, but we ought to come together to provoke one another unto love and to good works, not provoke one another to anger, but to provoke one another to love and to good works amongst ourselves and within the community. I believe this morning that when we get saved, if you could use that language, we ought to look for a church. If you're here this morning and you're searching for a church because you're new to the faith, I hope it's WPC, but wherever it is, please find a Bible-teaching church that's going to lead you in truth, that you can become a part of that local family of believers. Is the local church perfect? Absolutely not, because it's made up of people like me. It is not perfect. We have our bumps. We have our bruises. We have our flaws, but we are journeying towards Christ day by day. We are not perfect, but we are the church of Jesus Christ. No local church is perfect. The local churches written to in the Word of God, they weren't perfect. Man, they were messed up. Corinthian church in Corinth, they had a lot of problems. You think we got some challenges? You ain't seen nothing until you dive into what church in Corinth was like. We all have our problems, but if we are moving towards the goal, we're pressing towards the Lord Jesus Christ, the prize, the high calling of God, and that is to be mature believers of Jesus Christ, growing in faith, growing in our love one for another. And let me tell you something this morning. We said this a lot during the pandemic, and when the pandemic settled down and we were able to come back, and we said, look, it was great to be able to have church come into our living rooms, our cars, whatever the case might be, by way of the internet and what have you, or television, but it should never replace the gathering together of God's people like we've done this morning. Now, I'd love for you to say amen to that. We are not meant to be couch Christians, amen? We are meant and called by God to embed ourselves with other believers. We are not an island unto ourselves. I need you, and guess what? You need me. We're in this together, and that's the local church. And WPC, Windsor Pentecostal Church, obviously is a local church. A local church family. We have church governance. We have voting membership. And whatever your thoughts may be on that, again, that's open for discussion, not here right now. But we have organization. We come under the canopy and the affiliation with the Pentecostal Assemblies of Newfoundland and Labrador. I am credentialed with the Pentecostal Assemblies of Newfoundland and Labrador. I'm proud to be so. That don't mean I agree with everything, but we are loyal to our denomination, and I'm loyal to Windsor Pentecostal Church. And I trust you are as well this morning. With regards to the church being the family of God, there's a basic, and I shouldn't even use that word basic, there's a powerful premise, and that is this. Think about this. Just want to encourage you with this. There's a part of the family of God. God is your Father. Jesus is our brother. And believers are brothers and sisters in Christ. You understand that this morning? Let that sink in. God is our Father. Through faith in Jesus Christ, God is our Father, and we are His children. John 1, 12, 13, but to all who believed Him and accepted Him, referring to Christ, He gave the right to become the children of God. They are reborn not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. He gave us power to become the children of God. The moment you accepted Christ as your Savior, you were spiritually adopted into the family of God. And God is now your Father. Every morning. Maybe several times throughout the day. Sometimes it's sitting here alone. Sometimes it's driving down the highway. Sometimes it's in my office. I say these words, Our Father. And I make it personal. I take the Lord's Prayer on many occasions. Maybe nobody hears me do it, and that's fine. I don't do it to be heard. But my Father, which is in heaven, hallowed be your name. And I go down to the Lord's Prayer, and it begins with my Father. I cry, Abba, Father. I have the assurance this morning to go into the Father's presence with assurance and confidence, as a child always does, with a father who loves him. through Jesus Christ. We can go right into the presence of our Heavenly Father. When Jesus died on the cross, the veil of the temple was rent in two, and the place where no man could go before, we now enter through the shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And wherever I am this morning, I speak His name, and I have an audience with God Almighty. Do you believe that this morning? Through the name of His Son, Jesus, I'm brought into the Holy of Holies, and He sees me as His son. He sees me as your, He sees you as His daughter, and I have an audience. And like any good father, He doesn't always give me what I want, but He always promises to give me what I need. But I have the assurance that He's going to hear me. I have the assurance and the confidence that He's not going to turn me away. When I was raising our children, I like to think that whatever I was doing, they had an audience with their dad when they needed it. And for a number of years, my office was in my house and in our home in Marystown. And I'd be working in my study on the weekends or at night, and the door would be shut. Not very often, my wife used to say to me, "How in the world can you get work done with the noise that's coming from the rec room, which was just across the aisle?" And I had a way of blocking that out, to be honest with you. And our three kids, they knew how to make noise. And I had a way of blocking that out. But when they came to the door, whether it was Andrew, Jessica, or Josh, sometimes three, "Dad, Dad." And I'd stop. Did I always get it right? Were there times when I shunned them a little bit? Depends on how busy I was and how stressed things were. But I always tried to make time and say, "What do you need? Go ask your mother." I tried to make time for them. I trust I did well, and they could speak to that better than I can. But when I come before the throne of God, I come with an assurance and a boldness, not a brazenness, not a rudeness, not an ignorance, but I come with a reverence and a revered acknowledgement of who God is. Amen? I approach Him, yes, in fear and trembling, not afraid, but out of worship, and He never turns me away. I read this week, and I want to share it. He says, "The God who made everything out of nothing, and to whom all the stars and the constellations are but as marbles to a child, the God who controls all things that are, and who is from eternity to eternity, to whom the very nations are but as a small dust in the balance." The writer says, "He is our Father. He is my Father. He is your Father. And there's nothing so small and trivial in our lives that He is not interested in, and is prepared to allow the whole universe to go on by its own momentum for the moment, while He's listening to us and giving us His undivided attention." Is He your Heavenly Father this morning? The psalmist talked about how that God inclines His ear to us. And when you get into what that means in the Hebrew language, I believe, it means as if God cups His ear, as if He drowns everything else out when you come to Him to hear what you've got to say. That's my Father. I'm a part of His family. Jesus is our brother. The Bible says in Hebrews 2 and 11, Romans 8 and 29, Jesus, we are the brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ. He is the one who advocates for us. He's our elder brother. We are in that kind of relationship with Him. God is Father. He's our elder brother. We are His siblings, and He attends to our needs in the presence of the Father on our behalf. And we are brothers and sisters in Christ. You're my brother. You're my sister. We probably don't hear it as much as we used to. I got to be honest, it's not a word that I've often used in ministry, but in a lot of contexts, it's still very popular, where people are called brothers and sisters. You know what I'm talking about. I usually use them when I forget your name. So, John, if I forget your name tomorrow, I say, "How's it going, brother?" Then you know I got your name forgot. I usually first name basis myself, usually. But brothers and sisters, some of you still, how many of you still use that with people? It's fine. It's great. Yeah. It's a terms of endearment. We're recognizing that we are into the family of God. We are part of God's family. And being brothers and sisters, we have a responsibility. And I'll go there in a moment. So the family of God, our believers, have gone too far. Second question, how do we become a part of the family of God? very simply this morning. We've become a part of the family of God. I've already alluded to it by coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, by accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, by being born again. And that's what the Bible talks about. What does that mean? Nicodemus asked Jesus about eternal matters, and Jesus said to him, the only way you can inherit the kingdom of God, the only way you can have a relationship with God for time and for eternity, is if you're born again. And Nicodemus said, well, how can a man be born again? Can I enter again a second time into my mother's womb? And Jesus says, no, that's not what I'm talking about. He's not talking about physical birth. That's impossible. He's talking about spiritual birth. He's talking about being born from above. He's talking about being coming to Christ, coming to God through Jesus Christ, accepting Jesus Christ as our Savior. And God does an internal work in our lives. He changes us from the inside out. We are transformed by the power of God. We are born from above. God changes our heart. The spiritual transformation, where a new spiritual life is imparted to those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. It happens when we openly confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Paul said in that in Romans chapter 10 and verse 9, when we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. Folks, let me tell you, coming to God is the simplest thing in the world. Amen? It's the most powerful thing in the world, but it is simple as simply can be. You say, how can I be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you are saved, you are born again, you become a son or a daughter of God, and you become a part of the family of God. And we've had many people come to faith in Jesus Christ somewhere along the way. All of us began this journey of faith at different stages and places in our lives. We came and we acknowledged that we were sinners and we needed a Savior. And we were born again. We were saved. And we became a part of the family of God. And I trust this morning I'm talking to people in this place that every one of you have been saved, you've come to Jesus Christ, and you've been in the family of God. Maybe there's someone not. You're listening today. Here, you say, Pastor, I have yet to make things right with God. I encourage you to do that today. You're listening online, and we always acknowledge the online audience. Maybe there's someone today. You say, Pastor, I'm a part of a church. I'm a part of a local church, but I'm not sure if I'm a part of the family of God. It's interesting that people would fall in that category. Pastor, I'm a member of a church, but I have never given my heart to Jesus Christ. The church is an organization that you respect and appreciate, and I honor you for that. You're probably a part of that in an active way. I'm not here to knock that. But the most important thing you need to do is to be a part of the family of God. And the family of God is to be a part of His church by giving your life to Him, being born again, and coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The third question, how should we treat each other? This is where it gets practical, isn't it? And I could spend 2 hours on this. I have a number of little bullets I'm going to leave with you. Bullets, hopefully that won't hurt you. Galatians 6, 9 and 10. Let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. We are called to do good. And at a proper time, we will be honored for that if we do not quit. The problem is, we sometimes quit at that verse. And we're known for that sometimes, take verses in isolation. And that can be okay, but I want to give you the next verse. Therefore, that being the case then, he says, in light of the fact that there's going to be a reward for you that don't quit in doing good, he says, because of that, as you have opportunity, do good to all people. And he didn't stop there. He said, do good to all people. And then he says this, especially to those who belong to the family of God. Folks, we are to do good to those outside of our walls. I trust you're doing good. You're being good. You're doing good deeds. Faith without works is dead. We are to be kind and gracious to our community. We are to be good Samaritans to those who are broken and in need. And there are many in our community today who need someone to come alongside them and to care and to give them tangible things that help meet their need. And one of the things we do is support the various organizations in town that are trying to help those who are in need. We do it as a church, and I trust we do it as individuals this morning. Do good to all people, but especially those who belong to the family of God. And the way I interpret that, especially one another here this morning, how do we treat each other? How do we treat each other? Someone said to me the other day, the church is the only organization, the only army that shoots its wounded. That I almost cringe at the thought of that. When that was said, and I know it's a popular saying, but it almost tore something out of my heart. If that is true, it is sad. That the church is the only army that shoots its wounded, is the only organization that pushes people who are in need to the curb. That's a sad commentary. I trust it's not an accurate one, because we got to rise above that. We are to treat each other in a way that's worthy of the Lord Jesus Christ. How are we treating each other? As I said, I can expand on every one of these, but I won't have the time. Love one another. Don't need to expand on that. Everything else comes under that one. Love covers a lot, doesn't it? Do we love each other unconditionally? Do we love each other? Each one of us, those who don't think like ourselves or act like we act, and do we love them? Do you love me? Do I love you? If I don't, I can't say that I love God. If I don't love you, the love of God is not in me. We have to love one another. We welcome and embrace diversity into the family. And folks, I'm telling you now, that's going to be a challenge in the future. It's a challenge now. It's going to challenge our thinking. It's going to challenge the way we thought about different situations and so on. As we reach out to those around us, we have to be open to diversity. We have to be open to those who don't think and act and even look the way we look. We need to love each other. Where background and creed and color doesn't matter, we are the family of God. Can I get an amen to that? Diversity needs to be embraced, welcomed, and also embraced into the family. We certainly need to pray one for another. That's absolutely essential. And when you tell me you're praying for me, I'm going to hold you to it. Don't ever tell me that if you're not praying for me. Because there's times when you tell me that, I'm going to guarantee you, when you tell me that sometime throughout the day, that comes in my mind. And I say to myself, so-and-so said this morning they were praying for me. And I lean on that. I depend on that. So don't ever tell me you're praying for me if you're not. And I trust I will never tell you that if I don't pray. I will pray for you. Bear one another's burdens. You say, Pastor, I got enough burdens myself. I got a heavy enough load to carry. And I understand we carry burdens. We all do. You say, Pastor, you don't have any problems. No, I don't have a problem in the world. It's up to you if you believe that. We all have our problems. We all have families and different things we deal with in life, but we are to bear one another's burdens. I should be able to come to you, any of you this morning, and share my burden with you and trust you to keep it confidential, and you the same to me. We should be able to trust one another not to hurt us, to betray us, to push us when we're down, but to help carry the load. And that can be done in various ways. We need to encourage and build one another up. Folks, there's enough discouragement in the world, don't you think? People are being shot down in the world enough today. The church will be the safest place for us to gather. We should be encouraging. Do I need your encouragement as a pastor? Absolutely. I've had people almost apologize for encouraging me. Say, explain that. I've had people come and say, Pastor, I don't want your head to swell, but I enjoyed your sermon. You haven't got to worry. My head is not going to swell. Someone said that to me one time. I was starting out in ministry. He poked his head in my office. He said, I don't want your head to swell there, Pastor. But he said, you had a good sermon. I called him by name. I said, don't worry. By 4 o'clock this evening, there'll be someone going to come with a needle to burst that bubble. Don't worry. Say it to somebody. I enjoyed what you did today. Encourage them in their faith journey. Good to see you this morning. Pat them on the back. Job well done. And if you can't say nothing good, for goodness sake, say nothing at all. Amen? Don't discourage people. Don't attack people. Don't tear people down. Don't make things personal. Sometimes we may not agree. We may not agree with decisions. We may not agree with the organization of things or the decisions that are made. Don't make it personal. Love one another. Encourage one another. And encouragement means build one another up. Admonish one another. Love on them. Embrace them. Show our love and show our respect. Amen. Be kind. Someone said something the other day and it wasn't very nice. And I called them out on it. And they made an excuse for saying it. And the response was almost like, well, the church is no different than any other organization in town. I almost rebuked that person because that's not true. That's from the enemy. That's from Satan himself. The church is not like any organization in town. God forbid. Aren't we the family of God? Amen. You're pretty quiet this morning. We are different than any other organization in town. Because of Jesus, we treat each other with respect and love. We encourage one another. I'm not saying we can't address some things that concern us. Yes, we can. But we do it out of respect and love. Amen? If there's something you don't agree with, there's a place, there's a mechanism, there's opportunity given for that in the right place at the right time, but always done with respect and love. Never pushing someone down. Every now and again, we all need a pickup, amen? I'm not talking about a truck. Every now and again, we all need a pickup. Someone to encourage us. Find someone today. I've had people say to me, Pastor, I was going to call so-and-so, you know, felt to do it, and I said, oh, I cringe. I cringe when I hear that. Felt to do it because I'm sure the next words are going to be, but I didn't do it. I'm telling you what, Satan is not going to tell you to call someone and encourage them. He's not going to do that. So if you feel in your heart to call somebody and encourage them, that's from the Lord. Be obedient to what the Lord wants you to do. You say, Pastor, I've had people say to me, Pastor, you know, I didn't hear from the church when I was going through this difficult time. And people say, well, that's the pastor's job. We're all in this together. It's not only my job, it's all of our jobs to encourage one another. Amen? Because we are brothers and sisters in Christ. I happen to be your pastor, and I have a responsibility as a pastor to reach out as we do as pastors, but we are all in this together to encourage one another. I said I wasn't going to preach on each one of those points, but admonish one another. I think I've already touched on that. Spur one another to love and good works. Touched on that one earlier, I believe, somewhere along the line. Encourage one another to love and good deeds. Show grace and mercy to one another. Boy, do we need grace and mercy. Grace that was shown to us, we should show it to others. Live in peace with one another. Don't always be arguing and causing a fuss. The Bible says, if it's possible with me, in other words, do everything I can to live at peace with others. It makes for a lot better rest at night, doesn't it? When we're at peace one with another. restore one another spiritually. Galatians 6. If one is taken up in a fault, what do we do? If one is taken up in a failure, spiritual failure, we kick them to the curb? No. Do we say, you can't come in? No. We need to understand, but by the grace of God, so go I. We need to be kind and loving. And when someone is taken up in a fault, no matter how big that sin is, and we sometimes measure sins, we need to come alongside them as those who are spiritual and restore them, encourage them. Yes, there's such a thing as church discipline, and there's a process. The Bible talks, Matthew 18, read it, it talks about that. The Bible is clear on church discipline, but it's never to punish, it's always to restore. You need to understand that. It's never punitive, it's always restorative. And we need to come alongside one another and pick one another up when we fail. Consider others better than ourselves. Boy, that's a hard one, isn't it? Consider others better than ourselves. Put someone else first rather than ourselves first. You see, we're selfish human beings because of our sinful nature. We want to be on top, don't we? We want our needs met first. But let's be willing to step back. Let someone else go first. Esteem others better than ourselves. Look on the interests of others, and that's not being nosy. You know, we all know people who like to look on the interest of someone else. But that is, come alongside them and see what their needs are. Discover their needs and do your best to meet them. Respect one another. I think I touched on that. Forgive one another. We're going to look at that another time. Respect and forgive. When someone hurts you, you're now in a position. When someone hurts you, you are now in the position where you are required to forgive them. And that's not easy. But unforgiveness is a prison that we're going to talk about in a couple weeks' time. Another message. This is what it means to be a part of the family of God. And we can throw other points out, but I've covered a lot there this morning. And all of us need to look in our own hearts. I always say this, when I'm talking to you, I'm talking to me. I preach this sermon to me long before I preach it to you. I'm talking to me as well. We are part of the family of God. I'm glad to be a part of that family, aren't you, this morning? I'm asking Pastor Andy and the team to come. We're going to sing a song together, a couple songs maybe. Would you stand with me this morning? Quickly, love one another. Embrace, welcome and embrace diversity. Pray one for another. When I say embrace diversity, I'm not saying we have to agree with everybody's stance or everybody's lifestyle. But we have to love people and welcome them. Pray one for another. Bear one another's burdens. Encourage and build one another up. Admonish one another. Spur one another to love and good deeds. Show grace and mercy. Live in peace. Restore one another spiritually. Consider others better than ourselves. Look on the interests of others. Respect one another. Forgive one another. Give a helping hand to one another. Show each other that we are brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. If you're here this morning listening and you're not a part of God's family, I pray for you today that you would invite Christ into your heart. We're going to sing after I pray, and I'm going to ask you to do something this morning. You know, we don't gather on Sunday nights the way we used to gather. We are gathering, but of a different format. But we want to take time in the morning service for the altar time. You've heard me say a few weeks ago, lunch is not a priority for me when I'm doing this morning. It's a priority sometimes, but not on Sunday mornings. And I'd like for us to avail of the altar. We're going to sing this chorus that Pastor Andy has there, and I'm going to invite us to come. I'd love for all of us to come as a family. And we're just not going to embarrass you, not going to single anybody out. Pastor Derek is going to come and pray. No, you've already prayed. I'm going to lead you in prayer, yeah. So we're going to invite you to come as we sing it. Just come as a family, and let's celebrate. You see, the family of God, I know I touched on some heavy stuff there about our responsibility, and sometimes we get real quiet. We're reminded of our role. It's good to talk about the blessings of the family, isn't it? It's good to talk about our place in God's family and what that means. But when we start talking about what our responsibility is, kind of get a little bit uneasy. And sometimes I feel that little bit of that little wall goes up. I don't know why. Shouldn't. I'd like for you to come this morning, just for a few moments, as we sing a couple of songs and I lead you. I want to pray for you as the church today. Would you come as we sing? Father, thank you this morning. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this message today, and I pray it will find the right place in our hearts today. Lord, you know my heart today. You know, Lord, the sense in my spirit to preach the message the way I preached it. I pray that it will just resonate in all of us today. I pray, oh God, for our families today. Bless them. I pray for the church family. Bless this church, all churches today. Fill them, Lord, with people that long for you. I pray for those listening today who don't know you as their Savior and not a part of the Church of Jesus Christ. I pray this be the day, Lord, when they will commit their life to you by confessing with their mouth that Jesus is Lord, believing in their hearts that you raised Jesus from the dead. And your word says, when we do that, we shall be saved. Father, as we gather for a few moments now, have your way in our midst, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Here the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. I that the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in.
Oh, his love for me. Yes, his love for me.
Now let's gather around folks this morning for a few moments.
Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free. Child of God, yes, I am.
Free at last, he has ransomed.